Welcome to the last day at RSA. Well, I can't believe it's 7 days, 5 days. I can't even, it's a blurry week, but thanks so much for being here. You know, this was such a great conference, really great interactions, and you are in for a treat this afternoon. We have an incredible lineup. Former Prime Minister Tony Blair will be out here a little bit later. Yes. But before that, I want to explore the topic of choice. How do we make decisions? You know, I don't think this has ever been a more important topic for information security. If you look at some of the biggest attacks over the last year, the end of the story was some kind of sensitive data got exfiltrated. But often the beginning of the story was somebody made a choice. Maybe it was to install a piece of malware, open an attachment, click a link. And the question to me that's fascinating is how do people make those choices? We're in an era of big data where you can learn more about a person than they even know about themselves. So we've got some really great guests to explore this topic in depth. And I've been thinking a lot about how words and images frame a discussion over this past week. I had an interesting experience on Monday. I'd been doing a lot of TV interviews over the week, and on Monday, you know, we do this one interview. There's like a huge spotlight, so I will say up front that the lighting was not good. I just want to throw that out there at the beginning. I looked a little kind of washed out in a couple of the scenes, but I thought the interview went well. So that night, you know, Monday night, I'm in my hotel room. Somebody posted up on YouTube, and there's 30 comments. Man, I'm so excited. I'm like, this is a serious intellectual discussion on security. I can't wait to see how this played out, what people thought about it. I open up the comment thread. Comment number one, this guy looks like an egg. Okay, well, yeah, not perfect lighting. Okay, I'm like, okay, well, it's an anomaly. You know, let me kind of go further down the thread. Comment number two. Why is Jonah Hill talking to me about security? And it just devolved from there. There was a really concerning Penguin reference. There was a Marilyn Manson comment. And it was fascinating because the first person that got in, that set that egg stage, if you will, de-escalated the conversation. Everything was about eggs and penguins, and do you like it fried or hard-boiled? And it totally hijacked this thread. So think about that egg thing for a while, but not too long. I hope you forget it before the end of this session. And I had another interesting experience. My wife and I had a baby recently, which we're really excited about. Oh, thanks. Well, man, applause for the baby. Yeah. And it was fascinating because when my wife found out that she was pregnant, obviously she was the first person to know, I was the second, but Google was the third. And apparently they were so excited about it, they told diaper manufacturers and life insurance providers. And it was really interesting because as we started to search for things like calendars and furniture, all of our experience online with ads changed. It seemed like the whole web was targeted just to us. And a question that came up for me is, can this framing, this kind of interesting world that's crafted just for me, change the choices that I make? I mean, think about what you do online. Think about the searches that you make. Think about the information you reveal in social networking sites, voluntarily or involuntarily, like a friend of yours posts something about you. You confess to the web. The web knows more about you, in some cases, than your best friend. But if you think about that another way, what if your best friend was advising a car salesman on how to get you to buy a car? They'd know which buttons to push. Like with me, they'd emphasize safety. I'm pretty paranoid. You know, kids, how do you deal with rollover risks? And they'd know exactly how to sell to me. And if you think about an attacker, what if your best friend was advising an attacker on how to get you to open up an attachment? Do you think they could do it? And I think the answer is yes, probably for almost everybody. So The question that this session is going to try and address is how can we defend against that? How susceptible are we to it, and how can we defend? So I want to share one more story with you. As many of you know, I'm from the beautiful island nation of the Bahamas. Thank you for your tourist dollars over all these years. And just as if I can step away for a moment and say it is very cold outside. Many of you are going north after this conference. Why not treat yourself? Treat yourself to a tropical vacation. I had to plug it in there. 80% of our economy is based on tourism. And it's a really interesting political system. We're a democratic country. It's a two-party system, very similar to here. But it's not separated on the issues. Everybody pretty much believes in the same thing. We're all down with the fundamental, inalienable right of every foreigner to take a luxury tropical vacation. That's kind of like the baseline. But if you look at how the political messaging differs between the two parties, it's not about issues. It's all about imagery. Who sounds cooler? Who's going to do the most stuff? Who's going to bring in the most tourists? So when I was growing up, the party that was in power, you could just tell that they were starting to lose public sentiment. The other party was, more people were showing up to the actual parties. They had a cooler theme song. The grip of power was being sort of eroded. And I thought, well, how do we get back into the game? And they ran on a platform of shrubbery. So the shrubbery platform was, we're going to bring exotic trees into the country. We're going to line them up in the tourist areas. We're going to put them even inside some of the key constituencies. A tree in every yard is the phrase that I can remember. And this tree thing worked. I mean, everybody's really excited. Personally, I was excited about it. I'm like, dude, we're going to get a new tree. It sounded really interesting. And this worked. I mean, people were so excited about these trees. And so the other party was really kind of freaked out about it. They're like, dude, how do we counter this huge tree thing? And so somebody came up with the idea, I bet these trees could contain poisonous snakes. And so the rumor came out that, look, these trees are loaded with snakes. And then people made the connection, if they brought snakes in, they must be snakes. And there were snake ads everywhere. And if you talk to some of the political folks from back in that era, they say that this actually made a material impact on the outcome of the election. That's incredible to think that a word that you could tap into fear in that way to influence something so substantial. And I think on a micro scale in security, we deal with this kind of stuff all the time. We have to make choices every single day. When you're talking about consumerization, the proliferation of personally managed devices, everybody has to make increasingly personal but critical choices. So we have the perfect panelists, I think, to talk about choice, how people decide, how attackers may use words and imagery. And I'd like to welcome out our first guest, best-selling author, Dan Gardner. Welcome. Thanks, man. Have a seat.
What?
British mug?
No. Okay.
Hey, thanks for being here.
Glad to be here.
So I enjoyed your book, The Science of Fear. Yeah, and the scary part, I think, that I took out of this is that we make so many emotional choices. Talk to me about how people make decisions. Like, what's the mechanics of a decision?
Yeah, well, if you ask people how they make a decision, why do they choose this toothpaste and not that toothpaste? Why do they vote for that politician and not that politician? Why do they trust this website, not that website? Why do they worry about this risk and not worry about that risk? They'll usually shrug and say something like, well, I thought about the facts and I came to a decision. What else is there to it? And we know that that is wrong. That's a cognitive illusion. The most basic insight of modern psychology is that that is wrong. What really goes on in our decision-making process is that there are, we like to think, the psychologists call it basically two systems of thought. There's the conscious system of thought, which is what you think, you know, we're thinking about the facts that come to a conclusion. That's your conscious thoughts. But there's so much else that's going on. There are these unconscious thought processes. And psychologists, being very clever people, call these two systems of thought system one and system two. And system two is the conscious thought process. System one, and the reason why it's called system one, is because it precedes system two. It's automatic, it's instantaneous. And as a result, it delivers its conclusions first. And at that point, system two, your conscious thoughts, can get involved and they can examine those conclusions. And another really fundamental insight of modern psychology is that when we have a strong intuitive conclusion from system one that this is the correct answer, routinely, we will not bring to bear system two, our conscious thought, and examine that. And what that means is that these unconscious thought processes are far more influential in our decision making than we realize.
So system one is like the, dude, this tree has a snake. I can't let it in the country. Those emotional decisions, it's fascinating. If somebody wanted to use that to their advantage. I'm thinking about an attacker. You know, I get all kinds of interesting email, and it's really sad. You know, the good phishing emails are just gone. Guys that wanted to give me $5 million just for giving them a hand, I really miss that. Those business opportunities aren't there anymore. Most of these emails are either super boring, so they look like all the stuff that I get that are legitimate and boring all the time, or they're sensationalistic, like right around tax time. Oh, you cheated on your taxes. I didn't, just for the record. But tell me how this works. I mean, if I was an attacker, or even if I was a marketeer, there's this process that you talk about called anchoring, and I just found that fascinating. Yeah.
Well, the first thing, bear in mind, people have been trying to influence other people's decisions from time immemorial, right? And Amos Tversky, one of the pioneering psychologists in this field, once said that psychologists were simply catching up with advertisers and used car salesmen.
Oh, man. Okay? Don't think used car salesmen as pioneers.
Well, no, they're pretty clever. They're pretty clever. But, you know, this stuff is there, and it's very insidious. For example, let me illustrate this. What are the last two digits of your telephone number?
31.
31. So 31, an interesting number. No, actually, it's not interesting. It's completely irrelevant. So forget 31.
Dude, well, why did you? Okay.
Let me ask you another question.
All right.
Forget that number. Oh, let me ask you another question.
I'm purging.
Estimate how old Dwight Eisenhower was on D-Day.
Dude, I'm from the Bahamas. We only learn about pirates and stuff, man. Dwight Eisenhower was pretty old when he... I don't know, 30s maybe?
Okay. This isn't a magic act. I can't reveal the amazing trick. But what I can tell you is this, from lots and lots of research, is that that number 31, which we agreed was irrelevant, actually did influence your guess. So for example, if the last two digits of your telephone number had been 95, and I'd said 95, you would have guessed a higher number. That was the age of Dwight Eisenhower on D-Day.
It's amazing, and now that you say that, 31, I couldn't get that number out of my head. You know, you're like, dude, forget it. I'm like, oh, well. I tried to run a, you know, 3-pass wipe on it, but it didn't.
And that's the thing about these unconscious thought processes, is that even we're not aware of them, and even when we're thinking, you know what, I don't want to be influenced by them, we will be influenced by them. So for example, this is something that parents of young children will all be familiar with. Should you worry when you take your children to a park that, you know, there's going to be some stranger under the bushes who's going to snatch them away? Should you be worried about that?
Now I am.
Well, as soon as I mention it, right, what happens, whether you're consciously aware of it or not, is you'll try and think of an example of that horrible thing happening. Huh. If you can think of an example easily, then that thing must be common, and you will instantly have this intuitive sense, hey, this is serious, I should worry about this. That's called the availability heuristic. And it doesn't matter whether you're aware of the availability heuristic, and it doesn't matter if you're aware of the statistics that tell you that, in fact, this is not going to happen. It's extremely unlikely, and you shouldn't worry about it. You're still going to have that intuitive sense that this is a serious threat.
Yeah, that's amazing. Now that you say it, I think about an example of it. And, you know, I just think about that in the context of security. One of our biggest problems is we don't have good metrics. So you think about something bad that you heard company A suffered, and you're like, dude, I really got to protect against that thing. But it's hard to figure out where that should stack in your concerns. Like, I take my kids out to the park, and there's probably 50 other things I should be worried about. Them going into a bush and being allergic to something.
Absolutely.
As opposed to somebody stealing.
Absolutely. One of the standard findings in disaster prevention, and anybody who works in disaster prevention will nod their head when I say this, is that before something bad happens, you can't get anybody to be concerned about it. After something bad happens, you're going to get buried in money and concern. Even though, after it happens, of course, well, the horse has already left the barn. But that, again, is because of that intuitive, unconscious thought process, which is driving our decision-making to an extent which is irrational, which is leading us to make bad decisions.
Well, let me ask you about this. I mean, if we are so prone to these emotional decisions, it seems like today versus 10 years ago, I can know so much more about a person before I even approach them.
Right.
Like, I know who you are. I can read your articles online. I read your book. But you're a celebrity. I mean, there's a lot of people who aren't celebrities, and I can still kind of know everything about them. I read their Twitter feed. I read, and I go to ancestry.com and sign up for a subscription, and I kind of know their lineage and where they lived. How does that put an attacker or a marketeer at an advantage? Say if I targeted something very specifically to you.
Well, that's just the information, the superficial information which is available, and it's substantial. But you had mentioned in your opening talk, you had said, you know, what if they talked to your best friend and they had all the information your best friend had? Boy, would they ever be able to manipulate you. Yeah. Let me suggest that it's even more insidious than that.
I'm already paranoid, man. Okay.
The fact is, if it's true, as I say, that we actually, our decisions are driven by, in large part by unconscious thought processes which we're not aware of, that we ourselves do not have access to a lot of our own thinking. What that tells us is this: when you go out on the internet and you make all these decisions, one decision after another, after another, after another, after another, and there's this growing database about you, big data with sufficient analysis can eventually know you better than you know yourself. Because they're looking at your revealed preferences. These are the decisions you actually made. They're not your stated preferences, which may or may not accurately reflect your unconscious thought processes. They are your revealed preferences, which are much more valuable than your stated preferences. And that's why, again, I want to emphasize that, because frankly, in the world that we're moving into, I'm a little bit frightened about this. I genuinely believe that people who have access to this aggregated data can actually know us better than we know ourselves.
Huh, that's amazing. Because the choices, I guess, that you make, you may not even know you'd make it. Like, somebody can ask me, hey, if I was faced with A or B, I'd always choose A.
Right.
But unless I am actually in that situation.
Any psychologist will tell you, if you sit down with a focus group and you say, okay, which of these two brands of toothpaste do you prefer? Well, if they say, I prefer this brand, okay, that's fine. Now, why do you prefer it? Well, they'll give you reasons, but they may or may not reflect the actual inputs that went into that decision, because they don't have access to their unconscious thought processes that are so important.
And you know what's interesting too? I bring baggage into decisions, and I don't even know where it came from. Like, you know, I'm so baby focused now because we've got two of them. And I think about why we pick the diapers that we pick. And I'm convinced Huggies chafe. I don't know why. I've never been personally chafed by a Huggies, but I just kind of know that it's the case. But I, you know, and just trying to like piece back where I got this information from, I don't even have any sense
of it.
That's right. And so when I look online, I'm looking for, oh, Huggies chafe, and then there's like 50,000 people that agree with me, and I'm like, oh yeah, I knew I was right.
that's right. And well, you know, you mentioned there are the people who are available on the internet who agree with you, who can confirm.
Those guys are so smart.
Your belief. You know, if you
think I look like an egg.
if you remember nothing else from this talk, you know, the one thing I would emphasize is this, confirmation bias, because this is what makes all the other unconscious thought processes, unconscious mistakes that we make so pernicious, is confirmation bias, which is basically that once we believe anything for any reason, good or bad, we will go and seek out information that supports what we believe. It confirms what we believe. We won't ask if it's good information or not. We'll just embrace it and say, aha, I was right. And then we will not think to go and look for information that disconfirms what we believe. And if somebody shoves it under our nose, we'll rationalize a way to dismiss it. Well, if you think about that, if you think about all the ways in which your unconscious thought processes can trip you up and produce a decision which is a mistake, and then you take that and you add in confirmation bias, and you add in Google, and when we go to Google, what happens?
Or Bing.
Or Bing. What happens when we go to a search engine? We plug in keywords that are designed to find what we already believe. And because there are 7 billion people on the planet, adding information to the internet at all times, there's always information that confirms what we believe, no matter how nutty it is.
Well, let me ask you this. I mean, that's a relatively new phenomenon, evolutionarily speaking. How are we going to be able to adapt to this? I think about, you know, our kind of ancestors, and it's all about running away from the tiger.
That's right, that's right.
But now there's sort of this access to information that is totally, at least I would think, it's away from our wiring as
that's
a human
right.
to be able to process.
The critical word there is evolution. Remember that the brain is an evolved organ, and it evolved in an environment radically unlike the environment that we live in. It evolved in that ancient Stone Age environment of you know, the plains of Africa, right? And it works really well in that environment. All our unconscious thought processes, they work really well in that environment. But unfortunately, we're in this completely different environment. And so you might despair thinking, how on earth can we, with our Stone Age brains, cope with this information environment? And there is hope. And the hope is this word that psychologists like to use, metacognition, which
is
simply thinking about thinking. Take your consciousness, turn it back in on itself. Ask yourself, when you make a decision, okay, I can trust this website, I can't trust that website, hang on, before you click that mouse, ask yourself, where did that decision actually come from? Does it make rational sense? Does it stand up to critical scrutiny? In other words, you should stop and catch and filter the mistakes that are made by that system one non-conscious thought processes by turning your consciousness back in on itself. And when you look at the decision making of people who consistently make good decisions, you find that they all display metacognition.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah, I think you know, it's fascinating because that metacognition piece, it's really hard to do. You make so many of these reactionary decisions.
Absolutely, and let me tell you, I have three young kids, and you know what happens when I go to the park with my three young kids? I've written a book about how we make irrational decisions about risk, and there's a whole chapter in there about how children are not at risk of being abducted and murdered by strangers. Stop freaking out, everybody. And guess what happens when I take my kids to the park? I get worried. I look for the pervert under the bushes, right? But what happens then? I stop and say to myself, wait a second, I know the statistics, I'm gonna swallow that gut reaction, and I'm gonna apply a little rationality, I'm gonna say to my kids, go play, because you need to go play.
Dan, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate this.
Thanks a lot.
Bones, yeah. That's an interesting message about how folks are swayed by emotion. Our next guest brings in the perspective of one of the most emotional decision areas, I think, of human endeavor. I'm not even sure I want to elevate politics to a area of human endeavor, but we see this play out in politics all the time. People make very emotional choices. It's all about the framing of issues. Our next guest is a master at framing issues. He's a political pollster, but more important than that, he's one of the world's leading experts on how words work. So the right words to choose to tap into the right emotion. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Frank Luntz.
Man, that's a good logo.
Dude, welcome. Nice tennis, man. Thanks for dressing up for the occasion.
Yes, I asked. I wanted specially designed shoes that even Stevie Wonder could see.
Oh, wow. Yikes.
It takes a while. By the way, you know, I was listening to the conversation before, and they were talking about, should you be afraid if you take your kids to the park? And I'm thinking, if it's the park is in Washington, D.C., and Congress is in session, yes, be afraid. Be very afraid. So what can I tell you?
You know, it's interesting to see your work play out over the last few years. And, you know, there's a couple of Frank-isms I've seen play out in these political dialogues, especially the debates. Job creators. Was this you, man?
Well, the issue for job creators, the question was, do you call them rich people?
Yeah.
Which you might qualify. But by the way, just for the record, you people in this audience are the people who used to beat me up when I was in school. So it's a little bit intimidating. What you're trying to do is you're trying to find a way to connect to people, both intellectually and emotionally. You're trying to find a way to engage them so that you can have this dialogue, this conversation. And so much of politics is totally one-sided. You got some awful communicators out there and some great ones. Barack Obama is a great communicator. He's a great teleprompter reader. John McCain? First off, John McCain is so old it takes him an hour and a half to watch 60 Minutes. Second, his favorite painting is The Last Supper. He's the second waiter from the left.
Oh, man.
Bill Clinton was a great communicator. Tony Blair, who's going to come out in a few minutes, is a great communicator for Britain. But it's got to be two-way. It's got to be interactive. John Kerry, we were talking about John Kerry back there. The guy looks like the tree that threw apples at Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz. He could not engage. And if you got an email from John Kerry, you would erase it. If you got an email from Al Gore, you would erase it. If you got a letter from Al Gore, if Al Gore wanted to meet you, you wouldn't go. Is anyone here from New Mexico? Anyone applaud if you're from New Mexico? You've heard of Area 51? You've heard of Roswell, New Mexico? Tomorrow is the 64th anniversary of the alien landing in Roswell, New Mexico.
Wow, man, dude, I forgot to order my cake.
Did you? Okay, I do the jokes here. Did you know that exactly 9 months to the day that the aliens landed in Roswell, New Mexico, Al Gore was born? Now, I used to tell that joke back in 2000, and now this is no joke. 11 days before the election, in Gore's last appearance in the Rose Garden outside the Oval Office, a reporter asks him, "Sir, are you an alien?" And he starts pounding the podium, "I am a human being."
Wow, man, yeah. He would never say that if he was an alien.
If you have to assert, you're stepping on my line again. If you have to assert that you are a human being, there's no way in hell you're getting elected president.
Is that your rule of thumb? Is that your entry point when you go into a campaign? If you have to assert, is that your sales message?
That you are a human, you're going to have serious trouble, which is why Newt Gingrich will never be president. But that's a whole nother.
Okay. Well, moving right along to build on that topic, because that's the road I really want to go down. Let me ask you this. So you come up with these phrases, like energy exploration is kind of an interesting one.
Okay, watch. I need audience participation for this. Drilling for oil, exploring for energy. Which is cleaner? Applaud if you think it's drilling for oil. Okay, you're idiots. Applaud if it's exploring for energy. No, that's what it is. Which would you rather have for your kids? A voucher or an opportunity scholarship?
Oh my God.
You see, it's easy. Which do you hate more, an estate tax or a death tax?
Yeah.
Although I think we're dying right here, so let's be careful. You're trying to find words that connect. And again, I go back to it's both intellectual and it's emotional.
But does this stuff actually work, man?
Yes.
Like, do you see people change their minds? Oh, I'm not going to call it drilling for oil. I'm going to call it this energy exploration thing. Do you see that actually moving people, influencing?
We elected Jimmy Carter, didn't we?
Wow.
I've told people if Hillary Clinton had been elected president, she would not have been our first female president. Jimmy Carter was our first female president.
Well, that's our time, folks. Or not.
But I'm going to give you an example where the language got me tripped up. I got an email.
You tripped up? No.
I got an email from a congressman. And some of you may know this email, which is, help. I'm in London with the family, and I just got mugged. And they got my passport, they got my wallet, they got all the money, all the credit cards. I've been over to the US Embassy, and they promised to replace my passport, but I don't have money because they also got the plane tickets. We're on the way to the airport. If you would just send me some money for the plane tickets, I'll pay you back. Yeah. And it came from a US congressman. And I email him back. This is not in the last few days. This is when this email first came out. I've now gotten this email about 150 times. There's a lot of mugging going on in London.
Oh, very dangerous.
You got to distrust it if Tony Blair, if he emails you saying, help, I just got mugged in London, with the security people that he's got here. So I fell for that email because it came from a trusted source. The way that it was written connected to me. And in essence, in politics, that's what I try to do. I try to find ways to connect to people so they will give me a chance to be heard.
Well, this rush, this kind of, you know, London mugging thing obviously connected to you in some visceral way.
I went to school in Oxford for 3 years. I felt like I'd been mugged for 3 years. It was a very challenging 3 years over there.
How would you propose an attacker use language? I mean, you're talking about very smart, usually highly technical people. If you look over the last year, for example, at some of these attacks, really smart people have ended up clicking on an attachment, clicking on a link, and if you think about how you can frame that email to a person, I'd be very curious how you would convince such a person to click on a link or open an attachment. What words would you use, man?
This woman emails me, and she says that I may or may not remember, but we met in a bar about 8-9 days ago, and it was a really quick meeting, and she thought that I was kind of smart and not.
Well, that's when you delete, this has got to be inaccurate, yeah. No, sorry, man. No, sorry, go down. That's one of those like silent things that you say to yourself.
You're wearing a pink shirt, give me a break.
But you had to go there, man. Okay, go ahead.
Go wherever you gotta go.
I've already had an egg issue, and go ahead.
You know, you should not be doing drugs back there in the green room. It's just not good for this thing. The first thing you have to do is you have to make it personal. So people have to think it's directed towards you. The second thing is it has to be a call to action, whether it's positive or negative. It can be either. But there has to be a reason, something that says that I need to see this. And third, because we now have our barrier up, it's like that line at the end of 3 Days of the Condor. And it's also said in The Godfather, where someone you know will approach you, you'll know the person, and they'll offer you a sense of security. And they'll drive in the 3 Days of the Condor, they'll drive up and they'll tell you to get in the car. And you'll know them. And maybe you will, and that'll be the last decision you make. So it has to be that kind of approach. And there's a phrase here, you all are security people, you're trying to do with security. That's not what your clients really want. What they really want is peace of mind. You sell security, but what you're really providing is peace of mind. And I looked at some of the literature, and I don't see that language there. Security means that there is a threat, and that's what they address. Peace of mind means that I have solved that threat, so I can now breathe so much easier. And the second thing you all do, you realize, is that you save people their jobs. Or if you screw up, you cost someone their job. That's really powerful now. The idea that I don't have to be afraid because I got someone, quote, protecting, unquote, me.
Well, let me ask you to workshop this phrase to tap into your talents, man. So if you look at a lot of the security solutions, ultimately what the messaging is trying to say is we sell stuff to stop you from getting hacked badly and or fired. If you had to turn that into a frank phrasing, what would it be? And I'm going to look for it next year on the vendor floor, man, so give it to us. What is the right way to frame that message?
You didn't pay me enough to give you that answer.
We'll license it from you, man. We'll license. No, not really.
No, it's first thing is three words. I get it. I get the challenge. You actually describe to them the nightmare, but it has to be a nightmare that they could assume. The danger in this industry is if you go too far. If you try to suggest Armageddon, and that's just too strong. And by the way, I'm looking over your shoulder at me, and I am one fat dude. At least I got my teeth whitened.
That's what we were hoping for during this session, a self-realization moment, man. I'm glad that...
I know, it's like, and we got the psychologist that's back there, and now I'm gonna have to, I'm in shape, if you consider round to be a shape. So the first thing is, I get it. I get the challenge that you face. The second thing is, we've done it before, and here's how we've done it. And the third thing is, if you want to sleep easier, and it actually is that, talk to the people, the chief technology officers in these companies, and you ask them, they're the ones who are the most nervous, because to them, every day is a battle.
Yeah.
And if it ends today, then tomorrow is the same battle. So how are you providing them peace of mind that they know that when someone turns on that computer, the company is protected? And that's the key word in all of this. It's protected, protection. And one more, preemptive. The idea that you are preparing for the worst, planning for the worst, and that planning, prevention, preemptive, that's powerful language.
It makes a lot of sense. You know, the P words, okay. It's interesting because if you look at this industry, there's a lot of sensationalism too. And to me, it's scary. I mean, if you look at the names of viruses and worms, we've burned all the good ones, right? The ones that sound like Armageddon's happening, like Code Red and Blaster and Slammer.
And Pelosi.
Pelosi? It's, what? Okay. No, no.
You're not going there?
Refocus. Okay. So, given that all of these are already on the table, what's your recommendation, man? What horrific name do we put away in the vault just waiting for like this super virus to hit, man? We'll only pull it out in an extreme emergency.
None of that. The problem is that you so escalated the loudest sound that I can make. And the thing that they will pay more attention to is when I bring my voice down and I speak more quietly. The loudest sound is silence. And I actually take exactly the opposite approach. There's some company call themselves the quiet company. With everyone shouting at you and all these extreme language, the quieter approach people see as the competent approach, the effective approach. You shout if you have nothing to say. You're quiet if your work speaks for itself.
Wow, that's so insightful, man. it is interesting that you say that, because some of the malware that we're seeing today, at least some of the kind of effective emails that are being used to deliver this stuff, are very quiet. They just blend into all the other stuff. Like I said, I'm nostalgic for the Nigerian prince guy. I mean, it's now simple stuff.
I love that stuff. I saved so many of them. I was actually collecting all these different letters because I wanted to put this out. I miss that. I used to be very entertained by it, and I'm sure that every time I opened it, I opened up a virus. But it was fun to get that. You know what? Better a computer virus than another virus, but... The challenge today, and it is a significant challenge, is that you need to be able to communicate instantaneously. You got to communicate on every device that you have. People want to have access to every social network possible, and they don't want any firewalls, they don't want any barriers, because you realize the most powerful attribute right now is time. It's not even money, it's time. How can I do it immediately? How can I get an extra couple minutes in the day? How can I connect? So if I have a challenge at 2 o'clock, by 2:01, I've addressed it. And so that makes it difficult for them, because nobody's thinking about creating barriers to trying to lower the barriers so that you have this ability to communicate.
Well, I think one of our biggest challenges is communicating up to management. I mean, all sorts of other folks have metrics, right? You know, you talk to a guy that's launching a new IT project or a new website, and he says, well, if we do this, it's going to cost us X, but we think we're going to get revenue of Y. For us, it's, well, you know, we're kind of protecting this huge set of revenue, but we know how much it's going to cost, but we don't quite know how much it's going to save the company. How do you communicate? What words do you use in that environment when you know it's the right thing to sell up?
It's one of the reasons why we don't like our politicians, why we don't like our business people, why CEOs are less respected today, because the people who actually do the work don't get the credit, and we believe that the people at the top take advantage. And it's both political parties. George W. Bush, think of how much he accomplished when English was only his second language.
Dude, you're killing me, man.
I'm trying to figure out which, because I can't tell, do they get more upset when you tell a Democratic joke or you tell a Republican joke? But I will remind them that if I did this in Korea, North Korea, I'm dead. If I did this in Cuba, I'm in jail for 5 years. If I did this in Venezuela, I'm in jail for 2. When we can't laugh.
It's concerning how you know the exact jail term length. Just want to point that out.
For what I do, I have to. When you can't tell a joke about your political leaders, when you have so much fear about your job, when you can't afford gas prices that are now $4 a gallon, when you don't trust people to tell you the truth, when you could work for a company for 10 years and find yourself unemployed tomorrow, when you have all that is dividing us in this country and all the anxiety and the fears that people have, we're at edge, we're on edge. And this conference is so powerful because they're trying to provide peace of mind in a world and a society that doesn't have it. This is the answer right here. These are the people that, I wish that you had a way to communicate to kids who are 10th, 11th, 12th grade, to teach them that there are professions out there and there are ideas out there and things that are happening that they could become very successful and do amazing things. Because right now we are so pessimistic about the future that it's really quite frightening. And every time that you blow up a company, every time that you see another story in USA Today about another company who releases 30 million names and credit cards that go out, it just creates more doubt, more fear, more anger, less trust, and this is all bad for the American psyche. Our psyche right now has not been as bad in history. And so I hope that they're successful, because if they can instill, and here's the word for you, if you can instill confidence for the people that you work for, they will make the right decisions, and we will feel better.
How do we instill that confidence? I mean, it's still kind of interesting in that what we do most of the time is preventative. Now, if I tell you, take some vitamins and you'll get less colds, well, that's great, and you take the vitamins, but eventually maybe you stop taking the vitamins because say, hey, I haven't gotten a cold. I don't know if it's because I took the vitamins or I'm immune to colds in general. So in that kind of environment, how do you go up and say that, yes, this thing is valuable, and here's...
Simple. At what price for peace of mind? My dad died when he was 71, and I was in my early 30s. And he used to complain because he took a blood pressure pill that cost him $1. And my mother used to say to him, you get a chance, because my grandmother died at 46. And my mother would say to him, why are you complaining about this? Yeah. You get a chance to see your son grow into adulthood. And what is that worth? It's the same thing here. What is peace of mind worth to you? So that you won't have that meltdown, you won't have that virus, you won't have that disaster that affects your employees, your customers, or both. At what price peace of mind? If you communicate it that way, people are willing to pay for it.
Wow, that's great. And yeah, I couldn't let you leave without asking you this question.
Oh.
What frankisms should we be looking out for this political season? What's the next energy exploration, job creator, frank something something? what should we be looking out for, man? I want to establish a drinking game around it. That's really, it's a, more of an economic motive for myself, can you?
What is in here anyway?
it's already gone,
empty.
That's why. Yeah, so,
yeah. Watch this. Which do you have a better impression of? Capitalism, economic freedom? Applaud if you say capitalism. Applaud if you say economic freedom. Capitalism represents the CEOs. Capitalism represents big banks. Capitalism represents Wall Street. Economic freedom represents them. It represents the employee as well as the employer. It represents Main Street as well as Wall Street. And so my job in the lexicon is to try to get people to see the value of economic freedom without using the language of capitalism.
Wow, that's great. So economic freedom.
We can drink to that.
There we go. We'll toast to it backstage. Thanks so
Thank
much,
you.
Frank. Really
Thank
appreciate
you guys.
It. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Folks, again, thanks so much for being here. Thanks so much for the fellowship this week. You know, it's been a really tough year. It's interesting to get the opportunity to talk to all of you throughout the week. And I'd say if somebody went back and they labeled 2011, maybe they'd label it the year of the APT. And, you know, I wonder, you think about how you want 2012 to be remembered. I don't know how many of you got a chance on Monday to go to Innovation Sandbox. But if you didn't, I'd really encourage you to go next year, because what it proved to me is that innovation really is alive and well in our space. But it's not the academics that are coming from some equation to create a solution that's going to change the world. It's the system administrator. It's the IT security guy. It's the former CISO who's coming up with these interesting practical ideas to help people. And if I were to leave you with one challenge until we meet again next year, it's to innovate. And I think the innovation can come in three ways. It can come inside the company. There's things that you can do, ideas that you have, and I hope this week has given you enough peer support to actually push those ideas forward. But there's also taking those ideas to the next step. I mean, I we run this competition every year on Monday, and you wouldn't believe the caliber of people that were there this year. I mean, just some incredible solutions. So that's just on a personal note. I hope that when we meet again next year, I can say that 2012 was the year of innovation. And thank you so much for being here this week. I hope you have a safe flight home, and soon, former Prime Minister Tony Blair. Thanks so much.